Hello everybody, this is Dr. Vishal Trivedi from Department of Biosciences and Bioengineering, IIT Guwahati. And what we were discussing about the topics from your biology course for the class 11 and 12 under the program IIT PAL. And in this series, today we are going to start the new topic, and the name of the new topic is the animal kingdom. So you know that the animal kingdom is a part of the living world. And if you recall, in your previous chapter, we discussed about the different types of the organism, what is present in the living world, and all these organisms are being classified into the different kingdoms. So let's see what are these kingdoms. So in the living world, we have the six different kingdoms where the living organisms are being divided, whether it is the eukaryotic bacteria or the archaeocacti bacteria, protista, fungi, planti, or the anemia. So all these different organisms which are being part of that, all these kingdoms are having their exclusive characteristics. For example, the eubacteria, which is a unicellular bacteria and the prokaryotic cell. Similarly, the archaebacteria, it is also the unicellular and it is a prokaryotic cell. On the other hand, the protista, the bacteria what is belonging to the protista are the unicellular or to the multicellular, and they are the eukaryotic. On the other hand, the fungi, which is a multicellular organisms, and they are their cell type is the eukaryotic. And then you have the planti, which is a multicellular and the eukaryotic. And lastly, we will talk about the animalia is the multicellular and the eukaryotic. So the first question comes, and what you see in the following slide is the different types of animals. So what you see here is rhinoceros, what you see here is the deer, what you see here is the zebra, then you have the bear, then you have the fish, then you have the cheetah, you have the fox, then you have the eagle, and all these like lion, elephants and giraffe and all that. And what you can see here is that these animals are actually belonging to the different different in terms of the sizes, different in terms of their habitat, and different in terms of their feeding habits. So what makes these all them under the big umbrella of the animal kingdom? So before getting into the detail of this particular chapter, it is important to understand the what you will define as the animal and what you will define as the organism which are belonging to all other kingdoms. So animals can be distinguished from the other kingdoms by a set of characteristics. These characteristics are being provided by the Odris and the Odris, and these characteristics are: the animals are multicellular. So that is the first characteristic, that the animals are multicellular. Then the animals are the heterotrophic, which means they will obtain their energy by consuming the energy release substances. Apart from the heterotrophic, you also have the another mode of taking the nutrition, that is called as the autotrophic. Autotrophic means the organism which directly take up the energy from the sun, and those organisms are belonging to the autotrophics. So, and apart from autotrophic and heterotrophic, you also have the chemotrophics. So chemotrophics are the bacteria which actually acquire the energy by breaking down the chemical molecules. Autotrophics, so animals are mostly being heterotrophic, or almost all the animals are heterotrophics. Then mostly the animals typically reproduce by sexually, but there are exceptions where the animals are also reproducing by the asexual means, for example the porifera or the hydra. then animals are made up of cells that do not contain the cell wall. So that is very, very important. The one which is very, very distinguished character which makes the animal different from the plant or the fungi is that the animal cells do not contain the cell wall. Then the animals are capable of motion in some stage of their lives. For example, so the locomotion as well as the motility is a very, very important feature of the animal cells. But there are exceptions, like for example the porifera or the hydra. These are the organisms which actually are on the middle, like they can be able to do the motions, but they can also be stationary. Then you have the animals which are been able to respond to the external stimuli. As a result, they have the nerve cells, they have the muscles, and they have the contractile tissues or both. So the responding to the external stimuli is a very, very important and a characteristic feature of the animal kingdom. The plants do not respond to the external stimuli to the same way as the animals, because the plants respond to the external stimuli, but their responses are very different. They don't use the, or they don't have the nerve cells, muscles, or the contractile tissue, which means if the plant is going to receive the external stimuli, it is not going to show you any instant motion, whereas the animals are actually going to show you the motion or the reflex actions. Now, since the animals are having these characteristics, that does not mean that the all animals are belonging to, or all animals are having the similar kind of properties. For example, so if you see the animals, you have the approximately 1.2 million different species, and all these different species are different in terms of their feeding habits, in their habitats, in terms of their cell type and nutritional requirements and all that. And that's how the animals are very, very diverse, and their organization is also very, very complex. So in terms of the different properties, like for example, in terms of organizations, the animals are the multicellular. They can also have formed the tissues, or they can also form the organ or the organ systems. So in terms of the organizations, the animals which are exclusively having the multicellular organizations, then there are organisms which are actually only having the tissues, but they don't have the organ or the organ system. And then we have the very, very advanced level of the animals which actually contains the organ as well as the organ systems. The classical example for the multicellular tissues, multicellular organization, is the porifera or the sponges. In the case of tissue, it is the cylindrates. And then in the case of organ as well as the organ system, you have all the higher animals, like the annelids or the humans. Then their size, the size varies from very small to very large. For example, you can have the animals even in the range of the millimeter range, or you can have the animal as big as in the meter range. So in the case of the millimeter range, you can have the very, very small animals like ant, or even smaller to the ant. Whereas you can have the very large animals like blue whales and all other kinds of big animals like dinosaurs and all other things. Then they also vary in terms of the feeding habits. So animals could be herbivorous, carnivorous, as well as the omnivorous. So in terms of feeding habits, the animals who are exclusively only eating the vegetables or the green leaves, those are belonging to the herbivorous. Then you are having the animals which are exclusively eating the meat or the other animals, and those are all the carnivorous. And then there are animals which are actually being a herbivora as well as the carnivora, and that's how they are actually belonging to the third group, and that is the third group is called as the omnivora. In the classical example of the herbivora is like deer, rabbits, cow, buffalo. Whereas the exclusive example of the carnivora is all the animals which are belonging to the like lions, tiger, and jackal, and all that. And then in the case of omnivora, you have the animals which are eating the vegetable as well as the food. The classical example is the humans. So humans are the omnivorous, which actually can eat the vegetable as well as they can eat the meat also. Then the reproductions, as we said, you know, exclusively the animals are reproducing by the sexual mode, but there are exceptions where the animals are also been reproducing by the asexual mode. The classical example is the Porifera, which is also reproducing by the asexual mode as well as the sexual mode. Then in terms of the locomotions, the animals are non-motile as well as the actively motile. So in the non-motile case, you have the Porifera, which are like sponges, which are stuck to a particular portion, but they do have the motion which are being derived or which are being driven by the motion of the ocean. So which means like they can be able to move, but they can, their motion will not be by the self-driven. That motion could be because of the motion of the water itself. Then you have the actively motile animals, like you have the you know, different types of other like insects, you can have the humans and all other kinds of animals. Then in terms of the cell symmetry, you can have the different types of cells what is present in the animals. So what you can see here is that the animals are very, very diverse and they are very, very complex. And that's why it is difficult to group the animals in any of these organizations, which means you cannot be able to use any of these criteria to use and say, okay, this is the criteria I will use to classify, because you will, if you suppose I will use the organization. So what I'll do is I'll just these three, four, you know, subclasses. So what we'll do is the multicellular tissue organ and organ system. But if I use this particular type of property, what you will realize is that there are people, there are animals who are belonging to the multicellular. There are animals who are also belonging to tissue and organ systems. Similarly, you cannot use like even the feeding habits. Like there are animals which are herbivora, but under the special circumstances, they could be a carnivora or the omnivora. So that's why there is a difficult task to group the animals or to the classify them. But the first question comes, and the most important question is that why there is a need to classify the animals, and why there is a, what is the advantage if you classify the animals or any other particular type of organism belonging to a particular kingdom, which means why there is a need to classify a group of people or why group of organisms which are belonging to one kingdom or another kingdom, and what could be the advantage of classifying a particular organism belonging to a particular kingdom. So there is a need for animal classification, and that need itself is going to give you the idea about what is the advantage. The first is the classification allow us to understand the diversity better, which means if you classify the animals, then only you will be able to understand how they are being diverse, how the they are having a different types of properties, and that is actually being only possible if you can understand the diversity only when you classify them, because then you will realize that even if you do a, you know, classify into 10 different groups, you will still find some people who are not belonging to any of those 10 groups, and you might have to prepare another groups. It helps in the identification of living organism as well as in understanding the diversity of the living organisms. Then classification helps to learn about the different kinds of animal, their features, similarity as well as the difference. Once you classify a particular animal, or once you classify the animals what is present, you can be able to learn the different kinds of animals. Like you can be able to learn the animals as soon as you will discover the new animal. You can be able to understand their features, you can be able to understand their similarity with one group or another group, and you can be able to understand their differences from the existing groups. And that's how you will be able to get a lot of information. For example, if I am identifying animal A, so what I'll do is I'll just take out the properties. Like I will take out whether this animal is, what kind of animal it is. It is herbivora or carnivora or omnivora, whether it is a multicellular or the tissue or the organ systems. So what could be the body organizations. So based on these kind of properties, like the similarity as well as the dissimilarities, you will be able to very quickly be able to know what are the features of these particular animals and what are which group it this animal is actually belonging. So it enable us to understand how complex organism evolved from the simple organism, which means if you classify the animals, you will be able to understand the evolution of the animals. So how the complex organisms are being evolved from the simple organism, and that is actually going to give you the information in terms of their evolution as well as how the different organisms are being related to each other and how the simple organisms are actually allowed the development of the complex organisms and what would be the mechanism through which the simple organisms like the places where actually simple organisms have adopted a new feature or acquired a new feature and how they have actually acquired a new feature so that they become a very very complex organism. For example, you can imagine that there would be a herbivora and carnivora in the beginning, but once there will be a scarcity of, or you can imagine that there will be only herbivora in the beginning, because and that's how when there will be a scarcity of the green vegetables or the green part, then the some of those animals could have been evolved and formed the carnivora, or it could be other way around or the simple way, right? And apart from that, there would be some organism which were now even evolved even better. And that's how they started having a fooding habit where they are actually eating the herbivora, like they were also eating the vegetables and they are also eating the vitamin and the meats also. And that's how they are very, very advanced. So the omnivora, like the humans, are being evolved from the simple organisms like the herbivora as well as the carnivora. And that has given a very big advantage to the human, because if there will be a scarcity of the vegetable, they will easily eat the meat. If there will be a scarcity of meat, they will eat the vegetable. And that's how you can be able to understand the evolution part of a particular organisms with the help of the classification, because the classification will only going to tell you the how the simple organism is being turned into a complex organism. Classification is a tool which help us to deal with a great diversity of the living organism. It is essential to understand the interrelationship among the different group of organisms. So that is very important, because that is actually going to help you to understand how the ecosystem is working, how the different types of organism or different types of animals are relating to each other, and how that relationship is bringing a change into one organism or simple organism to and form the complex organisms. And that's how actually because of those relationships only, the one set of animals were actually turning into another set of animal, and that's how in due course of time the new species are being evolved and so on. And that all information you will get once you understand and read and do the classification, because until you don't do the classifications, you will not be able to see how the animals are being related to each other. And if you want to do the classifications, you have to use the set criteria. And what are the set criteria? You can have the level of organizations, you can have the symmetry, you can have the developmental stages, like whether the animal is belonging to the diploblastic or the diploblastic organizations, or you can have the segmentations, or you can have the notochords. So let's discuss all these criteria for the animal classifications. So the first criteria is the level of organizations. Now the level of organization, as we discussed, it could be the cellular, it could be tissue, it could be organ, or it could be the organ system. So in the cellular level of organization, the classical example is the sponge. The cells are in the loosely aggregate. So cells are being present in a loose cell aggregates, and these cell aggregates are only performing all the functions. So there will be no tissue, or there will be no higher level organization. All these cells are loosely packed with each other, so they are forming a big aggregate, and that aggregate is performing the function of all sort of function like reproduction, feeding, breathing, and all that kind of thing. What a particular animal cell is doing. Then you have the tissue. So what is mean by the tissue? The collection of specialized cells isolated from other tissue by a membrane structure. So tissue is a collection of specialized cells which are performing a distinct functions, and that is what is called as a tissue. What is the tissue level of organizations? The classical example is cylindrates, where the cells doing the same function form the tissue. So in the cylindrates, you have the different set of cells which are being come together, and they are being separated from the other set of cells by a membranous layer, and those cells are doing the some dedicated function. For example, some cells might be involved in breathing, some cells might be involved in reproduction, some cells involved in feeding, and some cells are involved in detoxifications like the secretory part, excretion parts and all that. But this is a tissue level organization. These tissues are then again going to come together and will going to form the organs. So you can have the different types of tissues which are actually coming together, and that's how you are actually going to develop the organ. So organ is a combination of tissue, where in a single organ you can have the tissue for detoxification, you can have the tissue for breathing, you can have the tissue for all that. So that tissue level organization is an even higher level of organizations. And the classical example is the platyhelmint, where the tissues are organized to form the organ specialized for a particular function. The classical example you can understand is that the tissue, organ level, is that you have an organ like liver, right? So in the liver, you can have, that is like in the humans, right? So in the liver, you can have the different types of tissues. You can have the tissue like the hepatocytes. So hepatocyte cells which are present in the liver are going to form a tissue which is actually being responsible for detoxification purpose. Then you can also have the Kupffer cells, which are actually going to be responsible for destroying the invading organisms or the foreign pathogens. And then you can also have the blood tissues, which are actually going to form the going to supply the oxygen and all that. So that's why the liver is a combination of tissues, different tissues, where all these tissues are there, is doing their dedicated functions, but the liver itself has its own specialized function. So what is the specialized function of a liver? It is actually being required to detoxify the toxicants, what is coming from the either through the digestive part or through the external part. Like for example, if you take any paracetamol tablets, that paracetamol will go to the liver and it is going to be detoxified, because whatever is required is actually going to be used for that particular purpose. But apart from that, whatever you have the excess, that will go to the liver so that it will get detoxified, and that detoxified paracetamol is going to be removed by the another organ, which is called as the kidney. That's how in the humans you have the different types of organs, like, and that's how these organs are actually forming the organ system. And that's how the another level, like where you have the organ system. So for example, the organs have associated to form the functional system with a specialized physiological function. So organ system now varies from the animal to animal. So organ system is a kind of like different organs which are coming together and doing some specialized physiological functions. For example, when you are breathing, you are actually utilizing, and you are, when you're distributing that particular oxygen into different parts of the body, you are not using a single organ. Like, you are only using the organ system. For example, you are using the lungs. So lungs are an organ that is actually being used to capture the oxygen from the outside. Then you are using the heart, and that heart is actually going to be used only to pump the blood, and the blood is another tissue. Like, so blood is actually a liquid tissue which actually flows within the arteries and veins. And that's how, by combination of all these three systems, you could be able to utilize and you could be able to give the oxygen to the every part of the body. And that's how the organ system could vary from the animal to animal. For example, you have a circulatory system. So circulatory system could be of two types. It could be an open system or it could be a closed system. What is mean by the open circulatory system is that where the heart is pumping a blood into an open cavity, and that from the open cavity the nutrients are being dissolved, and then it is actually distributing that in this nutrients to the different part of the body, and then it is eventually come back to the heart. The classical example of the open circulatory system is the cockroach, where a pseudo heart is actually pumping the blood into the hemocele, like the central cavity, and then it is actually distributing the nutrients or the oxygen to the different parts of the body, and then but there is no blood vessels or the arteries involved into the open system. Whereas in the case of closed system, you have a closed circulatory circuits. Like it starts from the heart, so its heart will send the blood to one part of the body, and then from that particular body the blood will come back to the heart again. And that is the classical example where the closed circulatory system is present in the human, like where the heart is sending or the giving the blood to the different parts of the body with the help of the arteries, and the different parts of the body are sending the heart back, the blood back to the heart with the help of the veins. And this closed circulatory system is more advanced compared to the open circulatory system, because open circulatory system does not have the recovery part, which means the blood is being put into the hemocele, and then from the hemocele the blood comes back to the heart, but it does not have the very efficiency. So because it cannot give all the blood or the fluid to the every part of the body, it only can give the fluid to the particular cavity, and from the cavity it will go to the particular part of the body. Whereas in the case of closed system, you have the veins and arteries and capillaries to every part of the body, and that's how you can be able to supply the oxygen as well as the nutrients, and you can be able to collect the excretory system or the toxic material from these organs very precisely. So this is about the level of organization. So in the case of level of organization, you can see that we have a very very simple system, then we have the middle system, and then you have a very very highly complex and specialized system. So that is what we have discussed about the level of organizations, and let's discuss about the symmetry. So you can have the different types of symmetry. The first question comes, what is mean by the symmetry? Symmetry means similarity in shape, size and number of parts on the opposite side of a median line or the plane. So symmetry means the similarity in shape, size and number of parts on the opposite side of a median line. You can see this is a smiley ball. So if I put a line in the center, what you see here is that it has one eye on this side, you have another eye on this side, then you have the half mouth on this side, right? And then you have the half mouth on this side. That's how this is actually a mirror image to each other, because I have divided this particular ball from the center. This central plane, if I put a plane, or you can imagine that if I put a mirror here, then whatever is present on this side is actually going to be present on this side. So if you can divide a particular object with a plane or with a line, and if those two parts are actually going to have the mirror image to each other, then you will say that there is a symmetry present. Similarly, for example, you have the A side. So if I put a plane of symmetry in the center, what you see here is that this part, like the left side, is actually identical to the right side. And that is what is happened when you, so you can imagine if I put a mirror in the center, the A is, half A is actually going to be the same as this side. Similarly, I have taken few more example like the butterfly. So if I put a plane in the center, what you see here is the this half is identical to this half. Similarly, you have the different types of object, like when have the kite, and if you cut it in the center, you can have this portion identical to this portion. Similarly, you can have this hexagonal. Hexagonal could have the symmetry in many planes. Like if you cut for any plane, you can have the two parts. Similarly, you can have the triangles. You can be able to cut the triangle from the center, and this portion, which is the left side, is going to be the same for the right side. Similarly, you have few more alphabets. So, for example, you have alphabet S, This S is a alphabet which cannot be divided by any plane. For example, if you divide like this, there will be no symmetry, because this portion, this side is not identical to this side, right? Because this side you have like this arch, whereas this side you have the, you know, bulge. Similarly, you can have this side arch, this side bulge. So S is does not have any kind of symmetry. Then you have the H. H could be actually divided by this way or this way, so it has a symmetry. Similarly, A already we discussed, so A has a symmetry. P does not have symmetry. Even if you cut like this or you cut like this, it is not going to show you the mirror image of whatever you have on this side. But for example, the E could be able to divide by this plane, so it actually this side is going to be identical to this side, and that's how this is also going to give you the symmetry. So symmetry is similarity in shape, size and number of parts on the opposite side of a median plane. And that's how the different organisms or different animals could also have the symmetry. So you can have the three combinations. Either you can have the asymmetry, which means there will be no symmetry, or they cannot be divided into two equal parts through any plane. For example, we have seen an alphabets like P, or we can have the alphabet like S. So if you have a organism which is belonging to like S or P, that is actually not going to have any kind of symmetry. You can imagine this, right? This is a symmetrical tree, right? So if you cut it in the center, this portion, like left portion, is going to be identical to the right portion. But if this side of the tree is actually having the more branches, and this side of the tree is, does not have the, you know, those branches, then this portion is actually not going to form any identical structure. And that's how this is a asymmetrical object compared to that this is a symmetrical object. The classical example for the asymmetrical animals are the sponges as well as the snail. Both are belonging to an alphabet which is S. So that's why it is easy for you to remember the class of animals which are belonging to the asymmetric class. The class is S, right? So S is also asymmetrical, and the sponges and the snail are the examples. Similarly, you can have the radial symmetry. So radial organisms, these animals can be divided into two equal parts through any plane. All the cuts passes through the center and appear like a radii. For example, you can have the example of hydra, starfish and sea anemone. So you can have a object like the star, and if you take any plane, like you take this plane, you take this plane, you take this plane, you can take this plane, like from the center, if you take any plane, it is actually going to divide the organism into an equal part. For example, this portion is actually going to have the mirror image to this, it's going to mirror image to this, it's going to mirror image to this. So if I divide this animal from the center, it is actually going to have the upper half very close to lower part. But that plane could be of many planes. So that's how this is called as the radial symmetry. Then you can have the bilateral symmetry. These animals can be divided into two equal parts with the one plane. The examples are dog, frogs, as well as the humans. So this is a, you know, the heart sign. So you can have the bilateral symmetry, which you can actually divide from center, and that's how the left portion is actually identical to the right portion. Let's see few examples belonging to the different types of symmetry. So in the case of asymmetry, where there's no symmetry or they cannot be divided into two equal parts of through any plane, example is sponges and the snail. So this is a periphera or the sponges. What you see here is a club or the combination of the different types of the sponges, but you cannot divide these actually by any plane. Like if you cut like this, this portion is going to be small, this portion is going to be big. If you cut like this, this portion, the top portion is going to be more and lower portion is going to be different, and that's how they do not have any kind of symmetry. Similarly, for the radial symmetry, they can be divided into two parts through any angle. An example is hydra, starfish or sea moon. So I have taken an example of the starfish. What you see here is if I have this particular type of plane, then this portion is actually identical to this portion. Similarly, if I use this plane of symmetry, then this portion is actually going to be identical to this portion. Similarly, so you can imagine that you can have as many planes possible, and that all plane is going to be cross through the center, and that's how this particular type of symmetry is called as the radial symmetry. And then you can have the bilateral symmetry. These animals can be divided into two equal parts. For example, the dog, right? So dog, you can divide like this, right? So if I have to divide like this, you can have one eye on this side, you can have another eye on this side, you can have one nostril on this side, you can have one nostril on this side, you can have one ear on this side, you can have another ear is like this side. So if I show you the full screen, it is actually going to be divided from the center. Similarly, you can have the butterfly. In fact, most of the insects, like whether it is a butterfly, mosquito, moth, or any kind, they all have the bilateral symmetry because you can be able to divide them from the center. For example, you can have one wing on this side, another wing on this side. Similarly, I have taken an example of a human being also. So human beings are also can be divided from the center, and that's how they can have the left side is identical to the right side, and that's how they can have also be a bilateral symmetry. So this is what we have discussed. We have discussed about the level of organization, we discussed about the symmetry, and now we'll discuss about the diploblastic and triploblastic organization. So these two things are related to the reproduction as well as the organization. So before getting into the diploblastic and triploblastic organizations, let's first discuss about how the reproduction as well as the development happens in the humans, in the animals actually. So in the animals, how the reproduction and in development occurs, you can have the first cell. So in the first, you are going to have the fertilizations where the sperm and the ovum, the two nuclei, are actually going to be fused, and then they are actually going to form the zygote. So just after the fertilization, it is actually going to form the zygote. Then the zygote will go through with the different types of cleavage as well as all other kinds of modification, and that's how the zygote is actually going to form a cell mass, which is undifferentiated or differentiated cell mass, and that's how they will actually go through with the different developmental stages, and that's how it is actually going to form the embryo, and that embryo is then actually going to form the adults. Now, the cell mass, what is going to be formed during the developmental stages, can be get arranged into two or three stages as a germline layer. For example, the place where you actually are actually going to form the, from the zygote, you are going to form the blastula, gastrula, and all other kinds of stages, and then you form the 8 cell stage, and 16 cell stage, and 64 cell stage, and all these then actually going to go through with the different types of developmental stages, and that's how they are actually going to form the different types of the germ layer. For example, here actually you can see that, so there are, you can have the the different types of germ layer, like the ectoderm, you can have the mesoderm, and you can have the endoderm. So once they form the germ layer, at that stage you can be able to see there is a diversity within the animal system. You can have the animals which are actually belonging to the diploblastic animals, like the animals which are actually going to have the two layers. You can have the outer ectoderm and the inner endoderm, which is going to be separated by the mesoglia. The example is Cnidaria. So you can have at this stage, for example, if your cell mass is formed, then it will differentiate and it is actually going to give you the two germ layer. So outer is the ectoderm, the inner is the endoderm, and in between you are going to have the mesoglia cells, and these mesoglia cells are actually the going to be separate these two layers. Similarly, you can have the triploblastic animals. In the triploblastic animals, you can going to have the three layers, the outer ectoderm, the inner endoderm, and then in the middle the mesoglia cells are actually so ectoderm and endoderm are also going to be differentiate, and then that's how they are actually going to have the three germ layers: ectoderm, mesoderm, and the endoderms. The classical example is all the animals which are belonging upright on the top of the platyhelminthes, which means fatty helminths, annelids, the worms, and then you arthropoda, and you know, all those are actually belonging to the triploblastic animals. So triploblastic animals are more advanced animals compared to the diploblastic animals. So then we'll move on to the segmentations. So animals could be segmented or the non-segmented, right? So based on the segmentation also, you can be able to do the classification of these animals. So some animals, their body is externally as well as the internally divided into segments with a serial repetition of at least some organs. For example, in earthworm, the body shows his pattern called as the metameric segmentations, and the phenomena is known as the metamerism. So this is the earthworm where you see all these segments are actually dividing the earthworm into multiple segments, and all these segments are actually containing the repeated organs. And that's how the earthworms has lot of segments. So based on the segmentation also, you can be able to divide the animals. Now the second is that you can also use the notochord. So whether the notochord is present or notochord is absent. Now the first question comes, what is notochord? So notochord is a rod-like structure. So notochord is a rod-like structure, right, which actually supports and made up of tightly packed vacuolated cells which runs along the mid dorsal line. So this is notochord is what you can actually be able to experience on the backside of your and notochord runs throughout your body, and it actually supports the dorsal line, and it also protects the nerves and all other kinds of the delicate organs. So the animals who are showing the vertebral columns are called as the vertebrates. So the animals who are actually going to have the notochords or the vertebra are also called as the vertebrates. The animals do not have the vertebral columns are called as the invertebrates. And that's how the animals are classified into the chordata and the non-chordata based on the presence and absence of the notochords, which means if the notochord is present, those animals are going to called as the chordata. If the notochord is not present, then the animal is going to called as the non-chordata. So, and the notochord is a central rod-like structure which is made up of vacuolated cells, and that runs along with the dorsal line, which means it runs on your backside. And that's how it actually protects the nerve cells and all the, you know, so there will be a bony part edges which are going to come out from this notochord, and that's how it actually going to keep the nerve cords. Apart from that, the animals could also vary in terms of the body cavities. So body cavity is a space between the body wall and the alimentary canal, which means, so that is a classical example or the classical definition of the body cord. But what you can see here is in a human being, you can have the different types of body cavity. For example, you can have the cranial cavity. So the cranial cavity where you are going to have the brain, right? So cranial cavity is going to have the brain as well as all the nerve organs. So in this portion, you can have the brain, whereas in the spinal cavity, you're going to have the spinal cord. And this is the portion where you're going to have the notochord, right? The dorsal portion, you are going to have a rod-like structure which is running, and that is actually going to protect the spinal cord. Then you can have the thoracic cavity, right? The cavity where you can actually have the lungs, right? So your chest actually. So the cavity what you have just below your chest is actually called as the thoracic cavity. Then you can have the abdominal cavity, and abdominal cavity is where you have the alimentary canals. And then you also can have the pelvic cavity where you can have the pelvic organs. So what you see here is that in a typical human being, you can have the multiple types of cavities. And what are the functions of these cavities? These cavities are actually providing or working as a cushion. So for example, if somebody is actually going to hit you onto the ribs, right, that hitting or that that heating is does not go and affect the lungs, because it actually provides a kind of a cushion. So it actually absorbs that pressure, and that's how, or the thrust, and that's how it distributes that throughout the body, and that's how it actually protects the lungs from getting any kind of damages. It allows the internal organ to grow and move independently from the outer body wall, which means it actually protects the internal organs, and as well as it actually allows them to make the movement without any disturbance. So based on the cavities also, the animals could be divided into the multiple groups. So body cavity is a space between the body wall and the alimentary canal, which means it is actually going to have a space. For example, if this is the alimentary canal, right? So if this is the alimentary canal where the food is running, and this is your external skin, right, or the body, then this is actually the body cavity, which is actually been traditionally been considered as a body cavity. So you can have the three position or the three situations: the place where you don't have the body cavity, the place where you have the body cavity, and the place where you can have the pseudo body cavity. So the acoelomates, or the animals, are which do not have any body cavity, right? And this space between the body wall and the alimentary canal is filled with a parenchyma. The classical example is the platyhelminthes, or the all type of worms. So example, I have taken an example of the flatworm. So if I cut the flatworm from the center, what you see here is that you have the three layers, right? So this central yellow portion, what you see is actually the digestive tract or the alimentary canal. This blue color thing is actually the body covering or the ectoderms, and in between you have a red color portion. This red color portion is a tissue filled region, and that is also called as the mesoderm. But this portion is not empty, and that's how they don't have a body cavity. So these are the acoelomates, because the cavity is also known as coelom. Then you can have the pseudocoelomates. So pseudocoelomates are having a body cavity, but it is also lined by the mesodermal cells. So the animals show a false body cavity, which is lined by the patches of the mesodermal cells. The false cavity is called as the pseudocoele. Example is Escalmentis. So you can have a nematode. So if you cut the nematode, this is the external body cavity, body covering, right, the ectoderm. Then you can have the tissue-filled mesoderms. Then you can have alimentary canal, and in between you can have the pseudo cavity, but that cavity is also been lined by the mesoderm. So this is not the typical way or the place in which the cavities are being present in the animals. Then the third example is the coelomates, or the true body cavity containing animals. So animal having a true body cavity present in the triploblastic animals, the mesoderms split into two layers, enclosing a body cavity called as coelom. The cavity is filled with a fluid known as the coelomic fluid. For example, in the cockroach, it is called as the hemocoel, because it is filled with the blood, and the cavity is known as the hemocoel. So for example, if you take an example of the annelids, so if you cut the annelids, this is the outer covering, which is also called as the ectoderm. Then below to the ectoderm, you are having a tissue-filled mesoderm. So that up to this, it is very simple to like the acoelomates. Then below that, you are actually going to have the digestive tracts. So you can have the mesoderm on both the sides, and in between you are going to have the cavity, which is called as the coelom. And if the coelom is being filled with a liquid, that liquid is called as the coelomic fluid, because the coelomic fluid is actually going to distribute, is being used to distribute the nutrients as well as the oxygen to the different parts of the body. For example, in the case of the cockroach, this is called as the hemocoel, because the body cavity is filled with the blood. And where the blood is present, the blood is going to be filled in this particular type of cavity, and that is actually going to be distribute the nutrients, oxygen, and it is going to collect all the toxic material from the body. So this is all about the different criteria, what you can use actually to classify the animals. What you can see here is that it is very, very complicated. For example, in the case of animals, which are actually the multicellular organisms, you can have the level of organizations, either it could be a cellular level or to the tissue or the organ system. So first, you have divided the animals into the two systems, whether it is based on the level of organizations. So it could be a cellular level or it could be a tissue or the organ system. Now within the cellular level, you can have the symmetry, right? So if you put the symmetry classifications, so it could be asymmetrical or the symmetricals. So if it is asymmetrical, and then if you go with the body cavity, then it could be acoelomates. So if it is a organism which is actually having a cellular level of organizations, it does not have any symmetry, it does not have any kind of cavity, then it is actually going to belong to a phylum which is called as a porifera. Similarly, if it is a tissue level of tissue or organ level of characterizations, then in the symmetry level, either it could have a radial symmetry or the bilateral symmetry. If it is a radial symmetry, and if it is a acoelomate, which means it does not contain any body cavity, then it actually can belong to Cnidaria or the Strychnophora. Similarly, you can have the bilateral symmetry. Bilateral symmetry, you can have the three different combinations. Either it could be acoelomates, pseudocoelomates, or the coelomates. If it is a acoelomates, it could belong to the Platyhelminthes. If it is a pseudocoelomates, it could be belonging to the Ascalmanthes. Or if it is a coelomates, it could belong to all other groups like annelids, arthropoda, mollusca, Echinodermata, Hemichordata, and the Chordata. And within these groups also, you can also be able to divide further whether it contains the notochord or it does not contain the notochord. Because you within the even the within the coelomates, you can still be able to divide further based on whether it contains the notochord or not. Because for example, these groups does not contain the notochord, so they are belonging to the non-chordata, whereas this group is actually containing the notochord, so it actually been belonging to the chordata. And within the chordata also, you can further divide based on the some more other characteristic features which are we can discuss in further classes as well. So with this, I would like to conclude my lecture here. In the subsequent lecture, we are going to discuss about the classifications of the in the animal kingdoms, and then we are also going to discuss about the properties as well as the we're going to take the representative organisms from the each phylum, and we'll discuss those characteristics in context to that animal. And so with this, I would like to conclude my lecture here. Thank you.